Hello, my name is Ben Warbank and I am the BIM Strategy Manager at Viewpoint. This video is about the BS1192 naming convention. So if there is one place that I would suggest is great for anybody to start in becoming 1192 compliant, I would say this is it, the naming convention. It's been around for a while. It's been around since 2007, when BS1192 was first released. And it sets out how we're supposed to name everything. So it applies to documents, to drawings, to models, and to data files. If we can start to adopt a common naming convention across the industry, it will actually be an enormous advantage. Clients will understand what something is and who's done it from job to job to job. In the industry, it will save us an enormous amount of time we currently spend with bespoke company inductions and training, because everybody will just turn up knowing how it is that they're supposed to label everything and communicate the work that they're doing. So, huge advantages. And of course, at Viewpoint for Projects, as a common data environment provider, we absolutely love it. Because as we head towards a data-centric world, it is the metadata which these filing and naming conventions provide which will allow us to do much more intelligent searches for information, not just on a single asset, but across multiple assets. So it's really vital as we move forward. So what is the BS1192 naming convention? So I'll take you through it now. So this is what the naming convention looks like. Yes, it's long. And yes, it looks complicated. But actually, these bits are optional. So in most cases, this is kind of what it's going to look like. But it's still long, and it still looks complicated. So let's break it down and show you exactly what each part means. So the first part is the project's number, which needs to be from 2 to 6 characters in length, in letters or numbers. This is to be used by everyone on the project. Gone are the days when each consultant has their own number for the project. So it's probably initiated by the client within the EIR. But if it's not, the information manager on the project will need to convey to all parties what the project number is that you're going to be using. If you must maintain your own project numbers as well, do so separately, because the numbering system won't work unless it's the same across the project for all parties. The second part is who the originator of the information is. So in other words, this is your company, the code that represents your company. And this code needs to be from 3 to 6 characters, again, in letters or numbers. It must be unique to your company on the project. And of course, this is what says who the party is that's responsible for creating the data that this particular tag relates to. The next characters relate to the volume or system. Now, it's important to say that this must always be there, even if there is only one volume. So this relates to a logical portion of the work. If a piece of data or a model relates to all of the volumes on a job, it's to be given the designation 00. The volume or system designation is 1 to 2 characters in length, and again, it's letters and or numbers. The next portion relates to levels and locations. It's always 2 characters of letters and or numbers. If it's multiple levels, the designation ZZ should be used. If no levels are applicable, then the designation XX should be used. GF relates to ground floor. 00 relates to the base level of a building or linear assets, so in other words, to ground. Floors above the ground floor are consecutive 01 for first floor, 02 for second floor, etc. Mezzanines have the prefix M, and then M1 would mean mezzanine above level 1, etc. All levels below ground floor have the prefix B, so B1, B2, B3 for each basement floor. So pretty straightforward. The next portion of the naming convention relates to the type of information that's been provided. So shown here are the file types for drawings and models. So for instance, M3 relates to a 3D model file. And these are the types that relate to documents, to the different types of documents that you may have. For instance, SN is a snagging list. The next portion relates to the role. In other words, what your company does. So each organisation must be allocated one or more roles within the project. And here's a list of what they are. So it's a single digit in this case. So A would relate to architect, B to building surveyor, etc. So remember, you might have several different architectural companies working on a large project. So the company designation is the second portion, but the role is that penultimate portion. And the final portion is the number. It's always four digits, used sequentially. The leading zeros should be used. But what about those optional bits? I think in most cases, these won't actually form part of the base numbering system. So the first bit is classification. So in this case, it might be Uniclass 1.4, perhaps Uniclass 2015, or Omniclass. You've got a suitability status, which is absolutely crucial, but doesn't have to form part of the base numbering system. So this is actually what, within Viewpoint 4 projects, will drive the workflows that you will run through. So you can see its SO is for initial WIP status, and then S1 through to S7 for suitable for sharing, etc. And then finally, you've got the revision status. And this has a prefix P for all preliminary revisions, so P01, P02, P03, etc. So during work in process, you can also have separated by a decimal a series of revisions that relate to an ongoing company approvals process. And then C is used for all revisions to completed work, for example, construction status work. So C01, C02, C03, etc. So that's the BS1192 numbering system. Even if you don't like it, it's a standard. And what else have we got that's been agreed industry-wide that we should use? We know that we need a convention for the labelling of our documents, data and models across all the items within a project, no matter who they're being produced by. So let's use it. And you know what? Within a week, once you've started to use it, you will understand what all those different bits, which at first do look complicated, are. And more importantly still, most of the numbering system remains the same from issue to issue. So for example, the project number, who your company is, what role your company takes, and actually whether it's a model or a schedule, for instance, will remain the same from issue to issue. So all you're probably doing is changing the revision status or perhaps issuing the next iteration, the next number. So it's not that complicated. And once we've got it, it'll be fantastic because we'll have that metadata across all the items on our projects, and we'll be able to make those really great searches, not just on one asset, but across all assets. Thank you.